I'm Misty Alt-Anderson with the HHS Office for Human Research Protections. I'm going to talk with you today about the basics of knowing when to apply the Common Rule, based on the revised Common Rule that was published on January 19, 2017. The Common Rule is part of the federal policy for the protection of human subjects, found in the Code of Federal Regulations at 45 CFR 46, and it has five subparts. Subpart A is the Common Rule. Subparts B, C, and D provide additional protections for certain vulnerable populations. Subpart E provides requirements about IRB registration. The Common Rule, or Subpart A, was revised, and the revisions were published on January 19, 2017, with a delayed implementation date. There currently are no revisions to the other subparts. The Common Rule applies only to nonexempt human subject research that is funded or conducted by one of the Common Rule agencies. For research that is funded or conducted by the Department of Health and Human Services, all five subparts apply. For research that is funded or conducted by another Common Rule agency, the other subparts may or may not apply. If you have questions about this, please contact your agency. So when you need to determine whether the Common Rule applies to a specific activity, first verify the funding source, and if it is conducted or supported by HHS or another applicable agency, then move on to determining whether the activity is considered to be non-exempt human subject research. And to decide this, you should ask the following three questions in this order. Does the activity involve research, based on the regulatory definition of research? Does the research involve human subjects, based on the regulatory definition of human subjects? And is the human subjects research exempt? Let's go through these questions one by one, and we'll have a chance to talk about each of those regulatory definitions. So the first question, is the activity research? The regulations provide a definition of research. Research means a systematic investigation, including research development, testing, and evaluation, that is designed to develop or contribute to generalizable knowledge. This definition remains unchanged from the pre-2018 Common Rule in the revised rule. What is new, however, is that the revised Common Rule specifies four types of activities that are deemed not to be research, which means they are carved out of the definition of research. Those four types of activities include scholarly and journalistic activities, public health surveillance activities, collection and analysis of information, specimens, or records by or for a criminal justice agency for criminal justice or investigative purposes, and authorized operational activities for national security purposes. We'll talk briefly about each. The first category of activities that is deemed not to be research is scholarly and journalistic activities, and these include the collection and use of information that focuses directly on specific individuals about whom the information is collected. The key to understanding this set of activities is what was right in the middle of that description. It's about only the specific individuals that are providing the information. So examples include oral history, journalism, biography, literary criticism, legal research, and historical scholarship. So the activities being done are the things that make the difference. So let me give you some examples. Looking at historical scholarship. A historical study about the life of a specific civil rights leader, and only about that individual, would meet the requirements of this set of activities. It's only about one individual and cannot be generalized to a larger group. So that would not be research under the regulatory definition. However, a historical study about the societal impacts of the civil rights movement and how it was driven by specific leaders in that movement would qualify as research under the regulatory definition. In another example, looking at oral histories. If a researcher or any professional is collecting oral histories of specific individuals about their experiences in a traumatic event. For example, the events on September 11th, 2001. But they're collecting individual stories and simply documenting those stories. That would not meet the regulatory definition of research because each one focuses only on the specific individual. However, if oral histories from numerous survivors of a traumatic event, such as the events of September 11th, were collected and then studied to learn about a relationship between those experiences and perhaps the lasting effects of surviving a traumatic event or the psychological effects stemming from that experience, that would meet the definition of research. The second set of activities that are deemed not to be research are public health surveillance activities. Now, there are two criterion that must be met in order to meet this carve-out from the definition. First of all, this only applies to activities that are conducted, supported, ordered, requested, required, or authorized by the public health authority. And the regulations provide a definition for who is the public health authority. This is an authority based upon either it could be a federal authority, the United States, one particular state, a territory, a political subdivision of a state or territory, an Indian tribe, a foreign government, or an entity of authority from such an agency, including its employees or agents. And it has that authority based upon an official mandate to address public health matters. If the activity is not being conducted by the federal, but if the activity is not being conducted by the public health authority, then it would not meet this carve out. So the activities, public health surveillance activities, what does that include? Well, these activities are limited to those that are conducted by the public health authority and are necessary to allow that public health authority to identify, monitor, assess, or investigate potential public health signals that might give information about the onset of disease outbreaks or conditions of public health importance. The purpose of these kinds of activities are to provide timely situational awareness and priority setting during the course of the event or the crisis and the handling and response to such an event or crisis that might threaten public health. Thirdly, the collection and analysis for criminal justice purposes. These are activities that are authorized by law or court order solely for criminal justice or criminal investigative purposes. These kinds of activities are necessary for the operation and implementation of the criminal justice system. Importantly, note that this would not include social and behavioral studies about the causes of criminal behavior. The fourth category of activities that are deemed not to be research are activities for national security purposes. These are authorized operational activities that are determined by each agency in support of intelligence gathering, homeland security, defense, or other national security missions. Typically, there's not a lot of this sort of activity that is funded and conducted by HHS. However, it does apply to other common rule agencies. For investigators that are conducting activities that might fall under this carve-out from the definition, we recommend that you consult with your relevant agency, perhaps the FBI, Homeland Security, et cetera, in order to determine whether these are authorized operational activities. The next question that you should ask, if you've determined that your activity does meet the definition of research under the regulations, is, does it involve human subjects? The regulatory definition of human subjects remains substantively unchanged in the revised common rule. However, there have been clarifications to the wording that make explicit OHRP's interpretation of this definition. So a human subject means that means a living individual about whom an investigator conducting research either obtains information or biospecimens through an intervention or interaction with the individual, and then uses, studies, or analyzes that information or biospecimen as part of the research. Or The investigator obtains, uses, studies, analyzes, or generates identifiable private information or identifiable biospecimens through the course of the research. I'd point out here that investigator can pertain both to a professional or to a student. It's about the activity that's going on. So let's look a little more at these terms, kind of these important terms to understanding this definition. Two of the terms that are included in the definition for human subject and have been there all along, the definitions remain unchanged. So just to review, an intervention can include both physical procedures by which information or biospecimens are gathered, for example, drawing blood, or they can include manipulations of the subject or the subject's environment for the purposes of the research. An interaction is some sort of communication or interpersonal contact between the investigator and the subject. Two definitions that show up in the revised common rule serve the purpose of clarification. Identifiable biospecimens are biospecimens for which the identity of the subject is or may readily be ascertained by the investigator or associated with the information. And identifiable private information means private information for which the identity of the subject, again, is or may be readily ascertained by the investigator or associated with the information. So what is the meaning of identifiability? Well, the definition in the regulations of identifiable remains unchanged. It still means that the identity of the subject either is or may readily be ascertained by the investigator or associated with the information or biospecimens. However, what's new here is that is a commitment from the federal agencies to collaborate at least every 4 years to re-examine the meaning of identifiability and to consider any new or additionally developed analytic techniques that might be capable of generating identifiable private information or identifiable biospecimens, which might not have been identifiable previously. So if the activity in question has been determined to be human subject research based on those regulatory definitions, the next question that you should consider is it exempt? In the pre-2018 common rule, there were 6 exemptions that could be used for activities that met those requirements. And by being exempt, they were considered to be exempt from the regulations, and therefore the regulations did not apply. In the revised common rule, there are now 8 exemptions. In general, some of these exemptions have been expanded. One has been replaced, and it has been removed altogether and replaced with a new exemption. And one of the goals here was to exempt more low-risk social and behavioral research that is able to be considered exempt and lessen some of the burden on IRBs. One thing to note is that with some of the expanded exemptions and the 2 new exemptions, number 7 and 8, They do require a new process called limited IRB review. And that limited IRB review is to verify that the conditions for those exemptions have been met and satisfied. We're going to list out for you the 8 exemptions in the revised common rule. However, we're not going to go into any detail about them. Another webinar in this series will address each of these exemptions. Exemption 1 in the revised common rule is for research that involves normal educational practices conducted in established or commonly accepted educational settings. Exemption 2 covers research that only involves educational tests, surveys, interviews, or observations of public behavior. Exemption 3 involves benign behavioral interventions. Exemption 4 is for secondary research for which consent is not required. Exemption 5 is for research and demonstration projects conducted or supported by a federal department or agency. Exemption 6 is for taste and food quality evaluations. Exemption 7 is for storage or maintenance of secondary research for which broad consent is required. And finally, Exemption 8 is for secondary research for which broad consent is required. And again, if you'd like specific information on these exemptions, please see the other webinars in this series. In review for what we've talked about today, this flowchart represents the process that you can use to decide whether the common rule applies to any particular activity that you're thinking about. The first question you ask yourself is it research based on the regulatory definition? If the answer is either no, or it is one of the activities that is part one of the categories that is deemed not to be research, then no, the regulations do not apply. If the answer, however, is yes, you go on to ask, does it involve human subjects? Again, by the regulatory definition. If it does not, if it does not meet the regulatory definition of human subjects, then the regulations do not apply. If, however, it does, so the research involves human subjects, the answer is yes, then you go to the next question, which is it exempt? If the answer is yes, and it meets the qualifications for one of the exemptions, I caution you to be sure that to double check and make sure that the IRB, that limited IRB review might be required for certain exemptions. That will be the case, and for others, it will not. Make that determination, and if it meets all of those necessary requirements for the exemptions, then the regulations will not apply. If, however, the human subject research does not meet the criterion for any of the exemptions, and the answer is no, it is not exempt, then you are now in the realm of non-exempt human subject research, and you will need to proceed to the process of IRB review, again, which will be also addressed in additional webinars on this topic. Please refer to the text of the revised common rule available on OHRP's website for a complete and accurate description of the regulatory requirements. For this presentation and the information provided here, please review the regulations at section 46.102, where all of the regulatory definitions are provided, and at 46.104, where you can find information on the exemptions. If you have questions about the revised common rule, please submit them to us at, via email at ohrp@hhs.gov. And please check out the OHRP website, which you can find at www.hhs.gov/OHRP for additional resources on the revised common rule. Thank you for your attention. We invite you to review the other webinars in this series and additional resources that we've provided on our website for additional information on the revised common rule.